So what do you think, Chris? Possible?
Oh, she looks fantastic. Yes, I mean, she's got the costume.
And she could have the talent.
Who knows? You never know. Costume's a good start, I always think. A look is very important.
What's going on here today, then?
Well, everybody's coming to sing to me and George, and it's a chance for anybody. You can come if you want.
Well, you'd better go in and do it, then.
OK, see ya.
All kinds of creatures turn up, but this one is rarely seen in daylight.
Hello.
Philip Salon, fashionista of the post-punk New Romantic set that included Marilyn, Lee Bowery and Steve Strange. Baby, baby, we like your lips. Baby, baby, we like your pants. All aboard
for fun. You've lived a large part of your life with George. How true to the story is it?
George has lived his life with me, actually.
I met Philip Salon, I was 16, I had a girlfriend called Laura. And we walked into this club. It was my first ever experience of, you know, seeing a club full of guys. And there was this creature, you know, up on the podium. And I just looked at him and I said to Laura, that's our new best friend. I think Philip fancied me the first time he met me. He'll deny that. I think he did. So he sort of marched over and he goes, hello, dear.
Hello, I'm Philip Salon.
Where are you from? And I said, I'm from Woolwich. He went, oh, the sticks.
But, I mean, I don't talk like this all the time and speak like that, you know. So if they cast that today, that would be a big mistake.
Philip is a bitch. I mean, Philip is a complete bitch. I mean, he's been calling me names from the beginning of our friendship, you know.
There was a certain kind of queen that George and I always hated. These ones that are really naff and pretentious, who, you know, they went to the roof gardens. They were like these ones, you know, when they get over a certain age, they just sit there being rich together and like, yes, how are you? How nice to see you.
Inside, the voracious press piranhas engage in a feeding frenzy and they move in for the kill. Boy George's charm machine is now set to full on, unlike Philip Salon's.
There's a girl in there right now. You know, she was like my slave. She was like a Philip Salon fan. But good, she can get lost. She's in there now, like, George, so fantastic. I love the musical. It's brilliant. God, you're so talented. I mean, he is talented. He's brilliant, but, you know, but he can make mistakes too, as we all can. You made a mistake being friendly with me.
Who's first?
Sheer weight of numbers means it's going to be a very heavy day.
All right, great. Sorry about all the our friends.
Oh, I love it.
Go for
the ordeal
it.
Begins, but who suffers the most?
The fact that people come and do such obvious theatre songs, it shows how little theatre has moved forward in the last 20 years. The thing that you're looking for more than anything is the kind of non-theatre voice.
Every day is like survival.
That's my favourite bit, this bit.
You're my lover, not my rival.
Thank you very much, well done.
As the day wears on, the makeup wears off.
Very good. Well done.
Back in George's kitchen, there's a song cooking.
Got to remember that none of these songs are in my key, so if I sound like Ethel Merman being strangled, understand? Bit faster.
I hear kids at bus stops saying, "Mummy, look at that funny man." I often ask myself why I do it, dress up like a freak. Put myself through it. Oh, it's time to take to the night, making sure you look just right. No fear when I'm in my finery, even when you laugh at me. I'm the only thing I see. I'm the only thing I see.
Around the age of about 11 or 12, 13, sort of when I was at secondary school, during the sort of summer holiday, I went off and had my hair done at Fidel Sassoon's, Hennard Orange, went back to school in plastic sandals and drainpipe trousers, and all the kids were like, oh, you're wearing your granddad's clothes, you know, but I felt special. And I think that is why I continued to kind of dress up and be individual was because it became a wonderful armor for me. You know, and the more ridiculous I looked, the more fearless I was.
There's only me in the middle
ages. Put the
amp in camp. I put the amp in camp. The androgyny. We put the we in with. You're it with a silent shh. Don't say it. Oh, it's time to take to the night. Making sure you look just right. No fear when I'm in my finery. I'm the only thing I see. It's
where
Morrissey is,
actually. Smith's vaudeville. One of the central characters of Taboo is the androgynous ex-pop star Marilyn, former confidant of George. It's 11 in the morning, and after a heavy slug of tequila, Marilyn is ready to spill the beans.
Triple tequila and coke. Rock and roll.
But first, he insists on a statement.
So, Marilyn, what have you got to say before we actually talk about Taboo?
Well, I'm just prefacing this interview with a codicil that is just saying that George and I, the show is basically, although it's called Taboo, it's called The Boy George and Marilyn Story in subtitles. George and I have come to know financial agreements with this show. Theoretically, I agree with everything. I like the songs he sung me. I like the characters' songs, the duets and the singular characters' songs. But until we come to terms, I theoretically...
Could you hold it just a second?
With the dog.
We've got, yes. Could we get rid of Roger, please?
Jane, hold the dog.
Right, okay.
You know, if he's going to use my character in this show to the large extent that he wants to use it, I just wanted this to be included just to make sure that he can't, you know, pull a fast one, contractual obligations and all the rest of it, percentages of the net and the gross and all the rest of it. And we haven't done the last one and not pay Marilyn because, you know, George is a multi-millionaire and Marilyn is basically in that thing outside the window, which is called the what? Gutter.
I can see the stars from the gutter. And if it all goes wrong, we got each other.
How did the two of you get together?
I met Marilyn, I think he must have been about 15 when I met him.
I met him at the Sombrero Club, about the fifth time I'd been there in Kensington High Street.
When Philip and Marilyn met, I wasn't talking to Philip, we'd had this row.
I met this this really weird, ugly guy called, what was his name? Philip Salon.
yeah, go on.
Philip brought Marilyn round to a friend's house, you know, to sort of rub my nose in it, and he was like, "Hi everyone, this is Marilyn," and I was like, I hated him on sight.
Because as soon as George and I met, it was just like we were sussing each other out and we were on the same kind of vibe and we were both very good looking.
You know, I thought he was beautiful, but I just was a bit jealous, I think.
He is very witty, Marilyn. I mean, he's got some, you know, he's funny.
Because, you know, I mean, everybody thought Marilyn was a girl. And one of our neighbours was like a proper drunk. And he used to see Marilyn kind of mincing up and down the sort of, you know, the balcony in his leopard skin dresses and corsets. And one particular evening, he tried to grab hold of Marilyn and realised that actually it wasn't what he thought it was. 24 hours later, he kind of axed our door down and we all had to jump out the window on the second floor. I dislocated my ankle. The police came and they said, "You have to leave. You're living here illegally." So we literally had to pack up our glad rags and go and get a pair of, you know, bolt cutters and find another house to live in.
I want my own skyscraper. I want to be a millionaire. No, not just on paper.
Would you say, looking back on it,
yeah,
that Marilyn was good for George?
No, not at all. He was really... They were terrible for each other. They destroyed each other, and they both destroyed each other. It was a two-way thing.
Philip, you know, did his best to kind of poison the two of us against each other.
I trust him as much... He trusts me and I trust him, but it's never going to be 100% because we don't know all the facets of each other's personality. You know what I mean? Like, and that comes back to the analogy of the diamond.
You know, I wouldn't blame one more than the other. I don't know. I mean, maybe one was, maybe Marilyn was more, but I think they just, you know, both destroyed themselves on drugs, and it's like, who cares?
You led a fairly reckless life with George.
Not reckless.
Well,
not,
a lot not, of drugs.
Not dangerous, no. We were never stupid. Never stupid.
Was there a drug that you didn't take?
Mind your own business.
I mean, you did LSD.
Who tells you that?
According to George in the book.
According to who?
According to George.
According
in the book,
to who?
You did drugs. You
listen,
did...
there's three sides to every story: yours, mine, and the truth. So a little bit of that, a little bit of this, and then you get the truth.
He can be, he's got his bad side as well, which we won't go into. She can be a shit-staring bastard, but so can I suppose, but not in that way.
George has done some pretty wonderful things for you as well, though, hasn't he?
Like?
He took you to the States, spent money on you, wrote songs for you.
No, he wrote some songs with Michael Rudetsky, the guy that died in his house, that were supposed to be for me. I don't want to get into this without sounding, because it makes me sound like I'm bitter and paranoid and nasty, and I appreciate all George's help.
You said in the book there are times when I could gladly have pushed Marilyn from a moving train.
Absolutely. I mean, Marilyn was, you know, an absolute monster sometimes. I mean, you know, he said all the things you would never say. There were times when, you know, you would want to say things to people, but you didn't want to be rude. Marilyn would always say them.
We've got a special relationship, even to this day, and we don't see each other that often, but I know I can always pick up the phone and George will always be the same to me and I'll always be the same to him, even though he's done some terrible, terrible things to me, but, you know, water under the bridge.
You know, Marilyn made me enjoy my success. He was like, what's the point of being famous if you're not going to enjoy it?
George says that you were the hardest drug to kick.
I'm complimented.
What does he mean by that?
He means I'm an addictive personality. I'm so fabulous. It's very difficult to boot me out.
Don't despair, famous Jew. I can see a legend in you.
Yeah, me too. I think Marilyn will like that song. It's very sweet.
George has a summertime booking as a DJ amongst the hordes of holidaymakers who grace the beaches and the boulevards of Ibiza. But that's a long, long way from his boyhood days in Eltham.
I was born in a cul-de-sac. It was a sort of two up, two down really house with an outside toilet, several chickens in the back garden. There was an Alsatian dog, there were kind of rusting cars propped up on bricks that my dad was always promising to mend that, you know, ended up being kind of art objects, really. Tins of paint everywhere and, you know, my dad's toolkits. And when you go up in the morning to go to school, there'd always be, like, a sort of posse of builders sitting around the kitchen table, drinking tea, puffing fags, eating sort of toasted bacon sandwiches. So, you know, it was a crowded joint, what can I say? I wouldn't say it was a happy home. I mean, it was a house of trouble. Sometimes, you know, when I came home from school, one of the telltale signs that my mum wasn't in a particularly good mood was there would be bottles of milk, full milk, on the doorstep at 3:30 or 4:30 when I came home from school. And you would open the door and you could really tell that, you know, things weren't good. You could almost taste the kind of disappointment, you know, like my mum would fill the house with her mood. And I do that. You know, I mean, that's one of the sort of qualities that I've inherited. If I'm in a mood, you know, and I'm angry or upset, it tends to permeate everything around me.
George, as an international superstar DJ, hits the party playground of Ibiza. In the 90s, George reinvented himself, and in Ibiza, he is loved as the diva of the decks. Even here, the press machine grinds on, and George has to take a break in his working holiday to do an interview. Enter David Wigg, top showbiz journalist, for an intimate and low-key interview at George's secret hideaway villa.
Thank you. Bye. Hello.
George, hello. Great to see you again. How are you?
Hot. How are you?
Very hot, but it's lovely to be here. I've just come in from London to see you. It's much better to be here.
David and George settle down for the encounter. With his pen poised and a new set of batteries in his cassette recorder, David starts off with a soft question.
Looking back once more at that period, the New Romantic period, which you were so part of, do you look at it with nostalgic affection, or what does it mean to you?
It was a very exciting time in my life because, you know, I wasn't at school, I was, you know, living in a squat, I was away from parental control. I could do pretty much whatever I wanted to do. You know, I was experiencing sex for the first time. You know, bigger eyebrows every day. And it was a wonderful time. You know, it was a time of incredible freedom and discovery. So in that respect, I look back at it with a lot of fondness. You know, and but I'm not really a nostalgia freak. I'm not the sort of person that sits around thinking, oh, wasn't it great back in the 70s or back in the 80s. I mean, I do tend to kind of get on with what I'm doing now.
And having got fame, what do you think about it?
I think it's much more deep-rooted than that. I think that if you grow up feeling like an outcast, fame kind of feels like a revenge.
Are you less stormy? You were very stormy, very temperamental. I saw a few of the rows, didn't I?
Well, you know what? I haven't been in a relationship for quite some time, so...
How long?
Long enough.
Years or months?
Blah, blah, blah.
Years or months?
It's been a while. I mean, you know, I have had sex, David.
Pardon?
No. I've had the odd shag. But what I'm saying is...
Relationship.
I mean, I was with somebody for 11 years. I was with Michael for 11 years. And we're still very good friends, but I haven't been in a kind of, you know, sort of very close relationship for quite some time.
What would really be your ideal sexual fantasy?
I'm a cuddler.
Are you?
Yeah, I'm really. I mean, you know, I do like sex, but my ideal sexual fantasy is probably no sex.
But then it wouldn't be sexual.
No, I mean, I think just intimacy is really something that I find the most erotic. Mm. Being with somebody, talking, you know, cuddling, kissing, you know, doing other things as well, but not sort of fast, let's get it over with type of sex. I like to take my time.
The interview and the afternoon draw to a close as dusk descends. George spins his magic. It's showtime. Understated, Philip tries to slip in unnoticed and has changed his Britannia number for something a little more exotic.
I often think to myself, why have I chosen a career where I'm constantly being commented about, stared at, when there's a part of me that hates that? You know, it's a really weird thing. It's like, if I go back to when I was like 16 years old, going to work from my parents' house to, you know, the train station, you know, dressed up in all the gear, I was just going like at 8:30 in the morning. I think, why are you looking at me? You see me every day. You know, why are you looking? And that's the contradiction of sort of dressing up. It's like, don't look at me. You're wearing this ridiculous clothes. And you're like, why are you staring at me? You want it, but you don't. And I think that's one of the contradictions of fame, you know, that you like it, but you don't really like it sometimes, you just want to be left alone. You go to Ibiza every year thinking that you'll have a little working holiday, but you end up kind of sleeping all day and needing to go to a health farm when you get back, so it's pretty stressful.
Autumn, and back to George's Gothic pile in Hampstead.
We were with you at the auditions. Yeah. You've been to Ibiza, you've come back. Is it fully cast then?
It's fully cast. The only thing that we're waiting on now is permission from Westminster Council to use the Notre Dame Hall as the venue for this show. And every day, we wait. I think the reason I bought this house was because the rooms are so big. It's not a massive house, it's just that the rooms are huge and, you know, there's big ceilings. And I think a lot of that is to do with the fact that I grew up in a very small house. I shared a room with four brothers till I was 17, so you really had no privacy. And that's probably one of the reasons why I live alone.
How can I love you, boy, when you don't even love yourself?
Tell me about John Moss. He found the house for you. Was he the greatest love of your life?
No, I haven't met him yet. He was one of the loves of my life, but I think my relationship with John was more obsessive than romantic. You know, most of what we did was fight and scream and make up. That's not necessarily a good relationship, is it? I mean, I fancied him, he was gorgeous. But fancying someone and wanting to consume them, you know, is not love, is it?
What is love?
God. If I could answer that question, I'd make you all happy.
You laid him out once, didn't you?
We laid each other out plenty of times. I mean, fighting. He broke his hand three times trying to punch me. Once I was out, as I was getting into a lift, he tried to hit me, and the door shut, and that was his hand gone. Another time on the bus, the tour bus, he started, and, you know, I said the wrong thing, and he hit the window and broke his hand. And then I think the third time, I threw a Coca-Cola bottle at him. You know the old Coca-Cola bottles, the big heavy ones? The really big, heavy bases. We were in Hong Kong, and he was trying to get me to do some press conference, and I didn't want to do it, because it had been flung at us at the last, you know, it had been thrown at us at the last minute. And I was tired. And he said, oh, you're disgusting, you know, you're a slob. I was like, why did you call me? And I picked up his bottle and then, not meaning really to hit him, but it did, on the head. And down he went like an animal in the wild. And I thought, oh my God, he's dead. And I opened the hotel room door and screamed. I had this sort of PA and driver at the time called Billy Button. He used to call him Chocolate Button. And I was like, Billy, I've killed John. He's like, oh, governor. He came running up the sort of corridor and putting his trousers up, you know. Not a pretty sight. He was like, oh, governor, what have you done? And John was carted off to hospital. He lived.
Do you still love him?
No, not at all. No. He could never love me as much as he loves himself anyway, so.
You used to think that if you were gay, you were born gay, but now you're not so sure about that.
I don't have any sort of hard and fast theories about it. I have lots of theories about it, but I think that I think the human being is a multitude of sexual possibilities. I think we're all confused. I think that, you know, a lot of gay people I meet are just as rigid in their sexuality and their opinions about their sexuality as a lot of straight people. You know, I think extremes create extremes. You know, we're all queer. Some of us more queer than others. And you can answer that by saying we're all straight, some are more straight than others. And that's it, that sexuality for me, summed up in a nutshell. You know, I mean, I had sex with a soldier the other night who said, I'm near gay, I'm just experimenting. I thought, well, you're very good at it, carry on.
Was that just a chance encounter with a Scottish soldier?
It was a chance encounter, yeah.
And where is he now?
He's in Afghanistan, fighting the war. I think I was the last shag before war. A wanton Vera Lynn.
And what are you two up to today?
Ah, today is all about, at the end of our second week of rehearsals, which is very, very early on, Chris has agreed with my request to show some of the industries, some of the newspapers. We've got half a dozen press in.
Isn't that a little bit dangerous, Chris?
Oh, I don't think so. We did a runabout one yesterday, so I felt that, I mean, no, we're fine. I mean, it's they're nerve-wracked, but I think it's great. I'm proud of it in the state it is at the moment, so I don't have any problem people seeing it.
Nervous? I'm not, actually.
I am. It's the press that always worries me. I've lived through so many first nights, and I hate the reviews. It's something I dread and loathe. And
sleep on the night of it. I mean, that's the only thing that worries me.
Oh, dear.
Any more changes?
Here and there.
Any more songs?
No, all the songs done.
All done.
Lurking in the corner is the fade to grey Blitz kid, Steve Strange.
There were good times and there were bad times. More good times?
Much more good times, yeah, much more good times.
Was your relationship a constructive one or a destructive one?
I think we sort of hit off on each other, and then there was strong competition, especially in the days of Billy's and the Blitz, with who could be the more outrageous, who could come out with the most striking of the images. And, you know, it was a competition.
But after all of that hurly-burly, you come out liking him?
Very much, yeah. Like I said, the George of now.
That's very rude. Stick in your interview, but I can't believe you're here. Hello. Nice to see you.
Hi, George.
So the cast are pleased, the hard-bitten audience are pleased, and the producer is pleased. To his friends and cousin to the Queen of England, is on an assignment.
That's fine, it's 22.
Okay, here we go, just a couple of.
George's mum has also come to have her picture taken.
All right, yeah, well, yeah, I won't answer anything I don't want to.
I know you won't. What did George's dad do for a living?
He was a builder. You know, general builder.
See, Dad, I told you I'd get into decorating sooner or later.
Was he ever violent to George?
Well, they had a moment. It was mainly verbal. George was very strong-willed, and he would argue with you till he got his point over. Like all siblings in families, like they called each other names, right? Which I never liked, you know. As a mother, you don't like your kids. Like, one was very dark, like tanned easily, so he was called a back the jam jar. And so to call George Pufter.
Okay, closer, George, go closer. That's better. The closer you go, the better for me.
Fantastic! Look at that trip! It's Ziggy Stardust.
He didn't like school either. In fact, wasn't he chucked out of school?
Yeah, and unfortunately, I worked at that school.
What did you do?
I was the dinner lady.
OK, George, very close. Very close. And go a bit to your left, if you don't mind. OK, just there. That is wonderful.
Fantastic!
That is wonderful.
When he got to about 15, he So I used to hate you, Mum. You were always had your hands in the sink. You were always scrubbing clean. And but I thought that's what Mother's done. But, like, I think, too, he resented the fact that his father didn't help. And, you see, Georgie was finding his feet then and was answering him back. And don't let him talk to you like that, Mum. And if you want to wear that, you wear that. And, see, Georgie could see all of that happening. And he didn't like it. And he did argue with his dad a lot. But he gave me a lot of courage, actually. Courage that I'd lost, like, from when I first got married.
We're looking. OK, George, here we go. It's looking positively terrific. Nose to me a bit more, George. That's it. Keep it.
The good thing about George is that fame has stayed with him.
Yes. Like, people keep saying, how come he's coming back all of a sudden? I went, excuse me, but he hasn't been anywhere.
He almost did go somewhere with a chaotic situation with drugs.
Yeah.
And you helped him out of that.
Yes. I wasn't aware what he was taking. And I didn't know what out of your head meant then. I mean, I know now he was out of his head, but at the time I thought, like, you know, why is he doing this? You know, I just couldn't fathom out. And then I spoke to Siobhan and she said, look, Mum, you know, he's taking drugs. Well, I was gobsmacked. You know, you've been given this gift and you're destroying yourself. And I remember putting him in front of the mirror because I know now that they don't see what you see. And I said, look at his shirt. He was half the size he is now. So skinny, it was frightening. Absolutely frightening. I mean, I have seen other people just before they died looking like it, and I was absolutely petrified. I think one particular friend that died shocked him into a senses, a Trojan, they called him. I think his death affected Georgie a great deal. And because I said, like, you know, are you going to be next, son? Did they say? Have I just to wait for a telephone call, you know, that you're next? I promise you, Mum, I'll stop. And he phoned a doctor himself and, you know, told him, I've got to stop. Who's that, George?
This is George, who's just going to appear behind you now. Or is it George O'Dowd?
Hello.
Hiya, darling.
The
fantastic. Yeah.
Don't stay on very long, though, so.
Let's get on with it then. Thank you very much.
Look at you, you're insecure, running down the street, screaming for attention, choker's lips and padded hips. Everybody's laughing, but you don't care. You're sick and you're twisted, irreverent, so beautiful. Look at me, don't stare. Goodbye, Satan's child. Goodbye.
Okay, I think we got it.
There you go.
Is everybody happy?
I'm happy.
Happy,
thank
George?
You.
It's been a pleasure.
Oh, that's really
thank
wonderful.
Thank you so much. I really enjoyed doing
this. That's a wrap then. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Patrick's pictures often end up in Buckingham Palace. This one ends up in Selfridge's store, Oxford Street. At last, the dream comes true. The show hits the stage and there's no turning back.
Give me a freak, any day of the week.
And we're not being horrible to anybody. We're giving everybody a fair crack at the whip.
I'm comfortable with those you call demented.
I mean, we're making certain characters, Philip Salon, particularly nice.
With space between their ears that can be rented.
Was there any big moment when you fell out with either Chris or George?
To be honest, I would have thought there should be millions of moments like that, and it might be more dramatic viewing to say that, you know, we did, but we didn't.
What I knew, you'd be a freak too.
If I was to ask you what is the best song in the show, what would you say?
Eye in the Sky, without a doubt.
I see the humour, oh, and the tragedy.
It's one we wrote initially and then changed the tune because I felt that it sounded too like one of the others. So George just instantly said, well, how about this? And started singing. I grabbed the guitar and it came together in about 2 minutes.
Now who do we think we are? Set our plans to bright shining stars. There was method in our madness, there's a rumor in the truth. There was love, but what's the use?
And that's where the magic is for me, when something just drops in your lap like that.
Touched by the hand of cool, I wanna be touched by the hand.
Hello.
I wanna be touched by the hand of cool. I wanna be touched by the hand of cool.
Hello, the viewer.
I wanna be touched by the hand of cool.
It must have been a very weird experience for him. Very emotional, maybe cathartic. Maybe it started. Maybe it's. I don't know how it must be for him to see his life represented on stage. You know, it's the sort of thing that usually happens after you're dead, isn't it?
Ich bin Kunst.
I like Ich bin Kunst. I mean, I didn't always. I found it a poison chalice at first because it's... You can't do it by half. You have to really throw yourself into it.
Kunst! Can't you see? Look at you. Then look at me. Oh, I am art. Your parody.
These songs are going to become standards, I think, a lot of these songs, and we're going to be sitting in auditions and hearing other actors singing these pieces and thinking, God, I was part of that originally, you know.
Songs I've written are some of the best songs I've written in years because there's a purpose to them, because it comes from your heart, and that's why I think it's so magical. I haven't been as obsessed about anything like this for a long, long time.